Looked at a number of different issues as to how all of you as oversight professionals can help potentially make strong investigations of unarmed shootings, understand what they are, what is an unarmed shooting, how do they define it, what are the legal grounds, the human performance factors which go into the decision making of when to fire, when not to fire, based upon the perceived threat presented. We're going to take a slightly closer look at what happened in Cleveland last November, and finally look at the role of the oversight organization in terms of your role in investigating unarmed shootings, community outreach, and policy ideas which are worth exploring. I am very honored to have a panel with me here today who graciously accepted an invitation to appear at this panel to provide three very unique perspectives, all of which converge on the same issue of investigating officer-involved shootings, especially when you have the context where the person who was shot turns out not to have a weapon. First of all, my far left is Professor Ronnie Dunn from Cleveland State University. He's an associate professor of urban studies. He's an urban sociologist who primarily focuses on issues related to minorities and the urban poor, with a particular emphasis on race, crime, and the criminal justice system. He's author of the book Racial Profiling, Causes and Consequences. In the middle, Django Sibley, Assistant Inspector General for the Los Angeles Police Commission. Django is a former police officer in Hull, England, graduate degree from USC, with research primarily focused on community, police relations, and crime control. Prior to joining the IG in Los Angeles in 2004, he worked for Eric Bob at the Police Assessment Resource Center. And finally, right next to me is Professor Brian Vila, Professor of Criminal Justice and Criminology at Washington State University. Formerly, he directed the Department of Justice's Division of Crime Control and Prevention Research. He's also a former patrol deputy and supervisor for 9 years at the Los Angeles Sheriff's Department many moons ago, and a former police chief in Micronesia. His specialty is really human factors performance. And I can tell you that as I met all three of these gentlemen over the last several months and putting this panel together, I've come to learn a great deal from all three perspectives. And I've had hours of phone calls with all of them. And how much I have learned, to try to distill that into 1 hour is going to be quite the task. So, with further ado, let's start with the first question of what is an unarmed shooting and why does it matter? What is the difference between investigating a shooting? What is a perception shooting? Now, when you hear the phrase unarmed shooting, you also hear it interchangeable based upon your department, based upon how it's classified. Unarmed shooting, perception shooting, state of mind shooting. My first question, though, is to you, Professor Dunn, in terms of perspective, when there's an officer-involved shooting and it turns out that the civilian who was shot is unarmed, what is the impact within the community itself and how it's perceived?
First, I'd like to thank you, Mr. Katz, for inviting me to serve on this panel. It is an honor to be here and present on the NACOLE panel. It is important to define and explain this from a community perspective, because the perception is in some communities, particularly those that have had a history of these type of incidents, particularly in Cleveland, for example, in the African American community, there's a long history of a contentious relationship that exists between the police and the African American community. So these shootings add to that historical narrative of racial oppression, and it also undermines the legitimacy of the police in these departments as a result of these shootings if they are continually found to be justified shootings.
Now, Django, this then naturally goes to the question of what is an unarmed shooting, of how is it defined. Now, some are quite easy. A civilian is shot and killed by the police, or is shot and wounded and didn't have a gun, that's called unarmed. But within that classification, there's a lot of nuances. Can you maybe talk about that a bit?
Yes, that's right. It's not as simple a matter to determine what an armed or an unarmed shooting is as it might seem at face value. It's also not a very useful guide to whether or not a shooting was in fact a legitimate act on the part of the police officer who pulls the trigger. So just to talk about classifications to begin with, there are many circumstances where a person may have access to a weapon. The question of whether or not that weapon actually presented a threat to the police officer, and that's really the test as to whether a shooting is justified or not, is much more complex than simply asking the question of whether or not a person had access to a weapon. For instance, here in the state of Utah, people are allowed to carry concealed weapons. Does not mean that the police can go around shooting them all day long, of course. Even if a weapon's possessed illegally, that's not a capital offense. And so the question is always, what did the person do with a weapon if in fact they had access to a weapon at the time of the shooting? There's also the very basic point that a person can present a very dangerous threat to a police officer without the use of a weapon. So for instance, a physical attack by a very strong opponent can be a life-threatening event. And so the fact that a police officer shoots a person in circumstances such as that, when that person doesn't actually have a firearm or a knife or something like that, does not necessarily invalidate the shooting. We also have many cases that I've reviewed, and in my career I've reviewed more than 1,000 of these, of officer-involved shootings and similar uses of force, where somebody will have something that is not a weapon but that looks like a weapon. So for instance, the use of airsoft guns by criminals to commit robberies is fairly common. For instance, and we've had a number of shootings where the person doesn't have a weapon, but they have something that looks just like one. We also have circumstances where people simulate weapons, and that's particularly common in suicide by cop scenarios. People don't have their own firearm to kill themselves with, so they will cause the police to respond, usually by calling the police on themselves, and then do things to create the impression that they have a gun that they're using to threaten the police officers, to cause the police officers to kill them. So within all of those different types of incidents, you can see there's many different shades of gray as to whether or not somebody is or is not armed. We do track this at the IG's office. One of the things that we do, and in fact the section that I'm in charge of, is the review of serious uses of force by LAPD officers. And for each case that we review, we will record whether the suspect used a weapon. So for instance, fired a gun, stabbed somebody with a knife, hit them with a baseball bat, something like that. Whether they displayed the weapon but did not use it, whether they possessed it but did not do anything other than possess it during the event, whether they simulated or had a facsimile of a firearm, or whether in fact there was no access to a weapon. And in each case, we check that and we track that. But as I said originally, that is only a very crude guide, or those categories are only a very crude guide as to whether or not the shooting that's under review was in fact a legitimate or a non-legitimate act by the police officer.
Right, and on the screen you can see some of the factors to take into consideration when that classification question is made, in terms of if the suspect was using a vehicle, was using it in an assaultive manner. Los Angeles Sheriff's Department, for example, will classify that as an armed shooting because the suspect was actually armed and using the vehicle as a weapon. Struggle over an officer's weapon. That's another one where the LA Sheriff's Department, for example, there's a fight with an initially unarmed suspect, but it's clear in the officer's mind, that in the deputy's mind, that the suspect is trying or grabbing at the officer's weapon, even gets control of it. We had one deputy involved shooting within a year or so ago where the deputy then resorted to his backup weapon because he had no control over his primary weapon. That was classified as an armed shooting. Now, Professor Vila, now from a human factors performance point of view, and in terms of perceptions and how people form decisions, how is that playing into the role in terms of armed versus unarmed, of determining whether or not a weapon is present?
So the it's the right question, I think. So the problem is it's a long way from the physical reality of, say, this room to what any of you or us is perceiving it at a particular point in time. Out of those things we perceive, how do we process that? How do we make sense of it? What are the biases that we might hold, or the the preconceptions that we have about that situation. It's a threat situation because we were sent there because it was a threat or not, for example. How much time do you have to make the decision is another one of those factors that plays heavily into it. How accurately could you perceive it? If they turn the lights down, tell me what the person just in front of you looks like, in a dim setting, for example. And then there's the issue of how much skill and how much training does a person have? Are they expert? Have they been doing this for a long time, for a short time? Are they tired or not? When we get tired, we get crankier, we make shortcuts. We're less able to make fine moral decisions, to apply rules. The frontal lobes that do all that fall asleep if you're too tired. How many of your departments work 12 hours, 12-hour shifts around the clock? A lot of them would be my bet. That puts people more at risk, especially on the graveyard shifts, but we don't attend to those things. So all of those pieces, it's what the person's physically and neurologically, neurophysiologically able to do that's really at issue here. And that's a difficult thing to marry up to the law, which is about rules.
Well, then, as I began working on this panel a number of months ago, one of the first questions I asked was, well, how often are people who are unarmed being shot by law enforcement? How often does this happen in the United States? I found that that was almost an impossible question to answer. So, for example, the Department of Justice keeps numbers on what they call justifiable homicides, that is, a killing by law enforcement of a subject while they're engaged in a felony. Now, I'm not sure how well their definition tracks up, matches up with what we do day in and day out of the officer-involved shootings that we may have oversight over. But the Department of Justice may collect numbers on what they call justifiable homicides, but it does not, for example, break down numbers, does not require reporting by law enforcement agencies of how many people who are shot and armed versus unarmed. Then there's a recent study, which was done by a professor at Valdosta State University, by Daryl Ross. And he basically analyzed 5,500 federal 1983 lawsuits over a 15-year period of time. He pulled out a sample of 1,100 and analyzed them. And his conclusion was, of that sample set of 1,100, about 19%, or about 1 in 5, of officer involved shootings involve a subject who was actually unarmed. That doesn't mean the shooting's a bad shooting. In fact, most of those findings were found to be in-policy shootings. But nevertheless, 19% or 1 out of 5, even unarmed civilian, who ends up being shot. Merrick Bobby just came in back in September 2011, published his 30th semi-annual report regarding the LA Sheriff's Department back in 2011. And one of the things that he really looked at was the issue of unarmed shootings. In his report, he used the phrase state-of-mind shootings, and that's an interchangeable term. And he found that the Sheriff's Department, the office which I have oversight over, from 2005 to 2010, about 21% of the shootings were state-of-mind shootings. 30 of 53 were waistband shootings during a 5 or 6 year period of time. We'll be taking a closer look in conversation about waistband shootings and that phenomenon in a little bit. My office, we've been keeping a close tally of deputy involved shootings. Looking at 2011, 12, 13 so far through June, you see that unarmed shootings have taken up a chunk of the shootings. 12 out of 38 in 2011, three of which were waistband shootings. In other words, furtive gesture, the subject reached for a waistband, which the deputy believed that meant that there was an imminent threat, so therefore the officer fired. 9 out of 49 shootings in 2012, two of which, person number 8 and person number 9, were in the same incident. That was a perfect example of what Jamba spoke about, the difficulty in defining where there's a police pursuit after a drive-by shooting where one of the suspects threw a gun out of the car. When there's a termination of the pursuit, two suspects ran in opposite directions. At this point, they had no gun. The officer still perceived, though, that they were a threat, and the shooting took place. And we'll be getting back to the waistband shootings and Merrick Bob's report, recommendations he made, and where the Sheriff's Department still is not necessarily matched up to those recommendations. General, the LAPD, you talked about classification just a moment ago, and we have Category 3 and Category 4 of Sept shootings. Can you talk about that just for a second?
Well, in terms of percentages, and you know, how often do we have those types of events? They actually are a fairly small minority of the overall number of cases that we see. They do occur from time to time. When they occur, they are invariably a matter of concern on the part of the community, also on the part of our office, and very often on the part of the department as well. As always, though, the question is whether or not they were reasonable. And as I stated earlier, the simple fact that there was no gun is only a very crude guide as to whether or not that shooting was reasonable.
Exactly. And Category 3 and 4, American College State of Mind shootings, where I was returning more call them unarmed shootings, LAPD's parlance is perception shootings. Category 3 is firearm present but not drawn. Category 4 is no firearm found. And you see there's very few Category 3 shootings in 08, 09, and 10 at the LAPD. But Category 4, again, perception shooting, no firearm found. 6 and 08, and for example, 5 in 2010. But again, that's just a number, doesn't mean anything. But in terms of the reporting aspect, and we just had a seminar, a panel just before this one in this room on reporting, in terms of reporting and transparency of that department, all of you may consider, should our department be reporting on unarmed shootings, having more delineated definitions so that we can report back to the community of actually what is occurring? So the first question is, what is an unarmed shooting? We've answered that. The second question now is, what does it mean? And that gets more to the legal aspects. In our thumb drive, we've included the two seminal cases, Graham versus Connor. All of you, I'm assuming, know, because that's kind of the bread and butter of what is defined as what is a reasonable use of force. And Tennessee versus Garner was the predecessor by about 4 years to Graham, which dealt with the question of can, in Tennessee, had rather lax rules in terms of shooting a fleeing felon. The Supreme Court said you can't, in general, just shoot all fleeing felons. Essentially, the fleeing felon has to present an imminent harm. Then 4 years later, Graham versus Connor, that court then delineated more so in terms of the objectively reasonable standard. And so, you know, that is, not only has that become the standard of the legal analysis in a civil courtroom, many police departments have, of course, not also adopted that standard of objectively reasonable. As we see, how does that translate into decisions to making use of force? In essence, has using that, not based upon hindsight, but based upon what the officer knew at the, excuse me, what just happened? What the officer knew at the time of the use of force. There's things to keep in mind. An officer does not have to wait and see. He does not have to wait for the weapon to be produced. Perceptions of behaviors and actions of the suspects can justify lethal force when they represent an immediate threat. And Professor Vila is going to be talking about that extensively in just a moment. We're talking about human factors performance. But the perception is what drives the conduct and the perception of the behavior of the suspect. And then finally, though, did the officer's conduct unreasonably create the need to use deadly force? And Jack, I'm going to turn to you for a second, because just a couple weeks ago, there was a new Ninth Circuit Court opinion, which really is now going to put the spotlight on that issue. Can you talk about that for a second?
Yeah, absolutely. One of the things that we've done that LA has done for decades now is to examine tactics associated with the shooting incident. So not just look at the decision to fire a weapon in isolation, but to examine the tactical decisions that were made leading up to, during, and after that shooting. And that's been part of the analysis for a long time in LAPD, and it's an analysis that we invest a great deal of time and effort in. When you undertake that type of analysis, you see very clearly often that the tactics used can increase or decrease the exposure of the police officers to the potential for a deadly threat, and thereby
increase or reduce the likelihood that the legitimate self-defense scenario is going to occur where the officer needs to fire a weapon to defend themselves from a threat. Traditionally, we've conducted that analysis as a separate inquiry from the decision to shoot itself. That's been viewed in isolation as an administrative matter. It's also been legally, on the legal front, been analyzed as a separate matter too, by and large. But recently there was a case, Hayes versus San Diego, which found that what they termed the pre-shooting conduct of police officers is part of the analysis as to whether or not a use of force is a legitimate act or not. And in fact, it was in connection with negligence. And so the question in that case arose from a case in San Diego where some San Diego County Sheriff's deputies elected to make entry into a house and confront a mentally ill person without first availing themselves of resources that were potentially at their disposal in terms of specialists who could to deal with the mental health situation that was taking place there. The court didn't rule on whether or not those pre-shooting actions were appropriate or not, but it did say that that decision to go in and confront the suspect was a part of that analysis. And so that is going to have an impact going forward, and I think a very good impact on the way that shootings are looked at least in California, because I can certainly tell you from my experience of having looked at very many of these things, very often the reason that we have a shooting is because of some substandard tactical decision making that preceded that event, and good tactics can very often keep officers safe enough that they're not going to need to discharge a weapon in the course of an event.
Now, Professor Dunn, the legal issue standards in terms of the officer does not have to wait and see, that the perceptions of the behaviors and actions of the suspect can drive the conduct of the officer. Is that understood, do you think, by the general public?
No, I do not think that it is. There are so many misconceptions in the community as to the procedures and training of police officers and how they respond in a deadly force or in an encounter with a potentially armed citizen. There's this assumption that I'm sure we've all heard after a shooting, why couldn't they shoot him in the arm watch it, that TV effect, that Hollywood effect. And the reality is officers are trained to stop the threat, and that's often with a center mass shot, which is going to be the torso or the head, and we know most likely that's going to result in a fatality. So there's a significant educational component that needs to be done through outreach to the community to properly educate them and inform them about policing.
And you think that's a role which an oversight body can take to try to educate the community?
Yes, I do. I think that they should serve as a conduit between the police organization and the community to make sure that the community concerns and perspective is present in police decision making, policy making, and training, but by the same token, helping to establish that understanding in the community of policing and the difficult tasks that police are charged with and the split second decisions they often have to make.
And that gives us the perfect segue in terms of the split second decision making, where Professor Vila has done some really cutting edge research, in my opinion, in terms of how human factor performance works, that decision making and deciding to shoot or not shoot. So I'm going to basically turn it over this part to him so you can kind of walk through the kind of work that he does and give you some examples of trying to take the lab and make the lab scenario as real world as possible to try to really get an understanding of how do the people make those critical life and death decisions when they're police officers.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you, sir. I'll try and make this brief because what we really want to do is answer questions and have a dialogue going back and forth about this. You laid the right foundation very much for what I'm trying to do. Most of what we know about deadly force encounters and how how people respond in them come from after action reports, legal cases, all of those pieces. There's very little that's been done experimentally, which gives us a much finer grained ability to understand these encounters. We have a lot of stories. We have a rich set of stories behind us. But as the me that's now a scientist instead of the old cop or police chief a long time ago, what I'm trying to do and what we're doing in our laboratory at Washington State is a high fidelity simulation, the kinds of things that police officers use to train themselves and that the military uses. We hack that. We develop scenarios to test people's performance when they're rested, when they're fatigued, under different settings. And we assess how able they are on average to manage this kind of scenario, that kind of scenario, and another. It's a rather new line of research. It's taken the last 6 years to get the funding, set things up, and run them. But we now have the experiments ongoing, and the first set of reports will be early next year, where we have the deadly force data done properly and the covariates analyzed. So that's where I'm coming from, and I'm just going to give you a vignette as an example of the sorts of problems we've been talking about here, and also to walk you through the real human factors issues in the scenarios that we run in the deadly force encounters that police officers and citizens experience on the street. I'll point out that the scenario I show you does have a weapon in it, but 45% of the scenarios, of the 60 scenarios that we have, don't have a weapon. They unfold just like the ones with weapons do, except there isn't really a gun there. We're challenging people both on the shoot and the don't shoot side, but in a much more sophisticated way than's usually the case. So this strange looking mirror I'm using to illustrate the fact that the questions that we're looking at right now have to do with justice on the street and in our communities. That's one face of this problem. But the other face is justice in the workplace for the police officers whom we ask to make these decisions. And the foundation for this, there's an ethicist at Princeton, Kwame Appiah Anthony, who has a lovely book and a line of research. And one of his core tenets is that if we ask of, that's a pretty one at least. So, what we ask of people, the rules and procedures and policies that we make, must be possible for them to do. And to shoot the gun out of someone's hand with an inherently unstable thing like a handgun at the end of all this, after you're running and panting and trying to figure something out very quickly sometimes, that's a lot to ask. It's hard to understand after you've watched television forever. Seeing all the things Bruce Willis can do with a fingernail file. It's hard for people to get that difference, right? So that's what I'd like to run through right away. So let's look at the basics. Now we use rules of engagement. So what is your objective? What are your limitations? That's considerably shorter than the 70-page versions that are floating around lots of departments in the country. This is the short version. This is the distillation that one thinks about running down the street or over the backyard fences and dealing with somebody. The goal of a police officer in a deadly encounter is to accurately identify a threat, neutralize it while minimizing harm to bystanders, to officers, and to the suspect. Okay, that's what it all boils down to. Arguably, and this isn't something we just pulled out of the air. We did it with a very high-powered and diverse group of experts talking about this. The nutshell here is that the probability of a tragedy in one of these encounters increases as the encounter is more complex. There are more people, there are less options. If we're doing it in this great big room and there are two of us, we can talk a lot. We have a lot of room to maneuver. We have a lot of options for dealing with things. We have less of an imperative than if we were standing in this room full of people and we have 10 officers trying to figure out what the hell to do in that much time, say. I can't even stand. Well, anyway, so much for my hipster act. But so these sorts of issues, if you have more people, if you have fewer alternatives, if you've got less time, poorer information, if you're more aroused, you've been chasing someone in a foot pursuit in the dark, and everything in your body's ready to fight, right? That's where you are. It's hard to control that. It's hard not to yell at your child when he does the same stupid thing for the 14th time in a day when you're tired, right? It's difficult to control this. Preconceptions are implicit biases, the things we're not necessarily even aware of, and the biases that come from what was the call that sent you there, what was the initial observation. All of those things affect what you're going to do. And then we get back to, and this is one of my research's focus areas, which is fatigue and work hours. We work cops and let them work and make them work sometimes. Very, very long hours, but everything we know from 100 years of research says that tired cops get cranky just like everybody else. They get less likely to make the right decision. They get more impulsive. And the problem is these are cranky, more impulsive, less well-thinking people with guns and other weapons whom we charge with doing these things. And yet we let them work long, long hours. So that's the end of my fatigue screed. We're making progress on all of this. So let me take you through one of these sorts of encounters right quick. And if you're feeling sleepy, okay, so here's your focus prompt on this video. This is one of our scenarios. You've received a domestic violence call. There are weapons in the house. I'm the police.
Freeze! Police! Freeze! Boom, boom, boom!
If I manage to hit him before he hit me, he falls. Now let's take this apart. If I get my heart to stop pounding, because that's the arousal part of these things. Let's get back down to this and just take it apart right quick, second by second. I went through the frames, or what used to be frames, the actions, second by second. Here we are. And let's look at, somehow it's not come back to us. Oh, thank you, we've got it. I tell you what, rather than fuss around with this, I'll tell it to you, and I'm reading it off the screen here. So at 3 seconds in, you're in the house and you hear shouting, right? 6 seconds in, you see part of a man. That's all you can see. 8 seconds, you can see a woman's head and that there's an assault going on and the man's doing it. 9 seconds, the woman's shoved out of view. 10 seconds, they've disappeared around a corner that you don't know anything about. 14 seconds, they're 10 feet away from you down a hallway, and you can see a man's head and one arm and the woman being held by the throat. That's all you can see. At 14.5 seconds, you see all but the man's right hand. At 15 seconds, there's a handgun visible, and at 15.4 seconds, the man shoots the woman up close and in very deadly place, wherever that's going. At 16 seconds, so that's 0.6 seconds later, the man starts shooting at you. And at 16.4 again, and at 16.6, the man shoots at you yet again. Let's see if we can... Oh, that's probably... Let me just show you the frames on this. There, we've got the screen back. There we go. All right, so we've tapped through all of these. Let's look at this frame by frame now. So here's the first shot that I got off. I was doing an interview, a media interview, and walking through this with a reporter. And about 2 months ago, I knew this talk was coming up, and we've been talking about it a lot. This scenario starts, I've forgotten about the reporter, and I'm on it. I know what happens in this particular scenario once I see the initial things, because I was involved in scripting it and everything, but I'm an old cop. And when you put me in a threat situation, all the old cop, my physiology went just talking through this thing with you. So the first shot, I got a decent shot, clipped the forearm and hit the torso. The second shot, I miss entirely. Why? Because it takes time to make the decision to shoot, for the firearm to operate, for the bullet to go downrange even a short distance and hit the person, and then it takes more time for any effect it's going to have on that person. Or I could have just screwed up the shot. The third shot, I'm following this guy as he starts to come toward me and is going forward. There's still a weapon in his hand right here. That's a blur. I fired again a torso shot, because shooting a gun out of his hand is ridiculous, right? The fourth shot, and this was the reason I told my research assistant to save this file for me so I could show it to you all in a couple months' time, hit him in the back. Well, I wasn't shooting at the back. At this stage, when I fired that next shot, this is about where the guy was, still with the weapon in his hand. By the time the bullet and he intersected in time and space, I've shot this guy in the back. Not that this isn't a pretty clear-cut shooting situation, he's just murdered a woman and all of those things, but just to think about the physics of this sort of a situation. So that's what I wanted to get across you. We've got very complicated physics, we've got very complicated aspects of human neuroscience, how decisions get made, how the brain and the body operate. We have very complicated situations. In this situation, the complexity comes, there's another person, and the hallway completely constrains what I can do. All right, I have very, very few options. And it's very difficult to perceive, because it's a rather dark hallway on top of everything else. So that's the baseline that I'd ask you to keep into our question and answer. Really, that's the fundamental problems with human performance and justice. Thank you.
Thank you.
Now, that was, of course, an example from a laboratory when you really looked at human performance. But I think when we look at what happened in Cleveland, Ohio, at the end of last November, is an example of where so many human performance factors come together with conceptions, preconceptions, etc. I'm going to have Professor Young walk us through it to kind of explain to you what occurred in Cleveland and why I think it's significant.
Okay, thank you. On the night of November 29th at approximately 10:27 p.m., a plainclothes officer in an unmarked car requested a license plate check on the 1979 dark blue Chevy Malibu. This vehicle was parked near a homeless men's shelter in the downtown area, which was known for high drug activity in the area. The plates came back clean. The officer attempted to execute a stop on the vehicle several blocks later. The vehicle fled. The officer failed to report this to the dispatcher, that he had attempted to make a stop or that the vehicle had fled. Minutes later, the Malibu passed the Cleveland Police Department headquarters, also downtown, at a high rate of speed, estimated at 66 miles per hour. two officers were outside the headquarters at a police cruiser, and they, as the Malibu passed, they heard a loud bang emanate from the vehicle. And you could see on surveillance video the officers actually ducking behind the patrol car. The vehicle sped through, and others in the area also reported hearing what they thought was a gunshot. One of the officers then got into his cruiser. The other officer was a computer tech officer working at the headquarters, so he ran inside to get his gun and his service belt, his equipment belt, while the other officer jumped into his cruiser and radioed shots fired and gave pursuit. Other officers obviously joined in at this point, and a 25 minute police pursuit ensued. The suspects were described as two black males, more than 62 police vehicles from five different agencies joined in this high-speed pursuit, which meandered throughout the city streets, down the freeway, and throughout a couple of suburban jurisdictions. Radio transmission during the pursuit, there were continual reports of shots fired and the passenger aiming a weapon at the pursuing vehicles. The subject vehicle ultimately turned into a school parking lot in East Cleveland, Ohio. That's an inner ring suburb, and this parking lot was a dead end. The lead pursuit vehicle clipped the suspect vehicle, causing it to change direction. The driver, the officer that was driving that lead vehicle, bailed out of his patrol car, stating that he feared being trapped in the car and unable to fire at the suspect, in that he's left-handed. So, mind you, his vehicle was still in gear and his partner was in the passenger seat. Yes. At this point, the vehicle is heading in this direction, but then it straightens up and heads towards the exit. He fires at the vehicle from the rear, and we do have a video animation of that, which you will see shortly.
Sure, and the animation you're going to see after this incident, the Attorney General of Ohio did his own investigation, and the diagram, the animation you're about to see, is an overhead view of the vehicle entering the parking lot and ensuing shooting, which they're able to correlate through time by the open microphones and radio broadcasts of the officers. I'm skipping this shooting scene. It takes too long, just about 2 minutes. I'm going to go straight to the animation. There is sound.
One of the officers stood on the hood of the vehicle, firing into the suspect vehicle, while the the shooting was still taking place, still underway. In all, 13 Cleveland police officers reportedly fired at least 137 shots at the suspect vehicle in 17.8 seconds. I say reportedly because the investigative team could not confirm this shot count because the Cleveland Police Department had inventoried the weapons and ammunition prior to the attorney, the Bureau of Criminal Investigation team taking over the investigation. The decedents were Timothy Russell, the driver, 43-year-old African-American male. He was shot 23 times, primarily in the head, neck, and upper torso. Melissa Williams was the passenger, 30-year-old African-American female, 24 gunshot wounds to the head, neck, and upper torso as well. The toxicology report on both showed cocaine in their systems. Timothy had alcohol and nicotine as well, while Melissa had marijuana and nicotine. Timothy had two prior police contacts with the Cleveland Police Department. He had multiple arrests for drug offenses and DUIs, as well as fleeing and eluding from other police jurisdictions. Melissa had 33 prior police contacts with the Cleveland Police Department. She had multiple arrests for drug offenses and mental health interventions. The investigative team was comprised of the Bureau of Criminal Investigation out of the Attorney General's Office, the Cuyahoga County Sheriff's Department, and the East Cleveland Police Department. Forensic mechanic did an analysis, an examination of the engine of the Malibu, and it was determined that this vehicle was prone to backfiring. So that was likely the loud bang that was heard by the officers and others suspected of being a gunshot. And this was also reported throughout the pursuit that shots were being fired, so the car was obviously continually backfiring. No weapons nor shell casings were found in the vehicle nor along the pursuit route. The gunpowder residue tests were inconclusive due to the high volume of bullets fired into the vehicle, so they couldn't determine whether or not the suspects or the decedents had actually fired a weapon. The Attorney General concluded that this incident, the chase and shooting, was a result of a systemic failure of the Cleveland Police Department. He termed it a failure in communications, command and control, and he stated the system failed. Disciplinary actions that have been taken thus far, 12 supervisors have been disciplined. One fired, two demoted, nine suspended from anywhere from 1 to 30 days. The 75 police officers, Cleveland police officers, that did not engage in the shooting, but did and were involved in the pursuit, were also, they're currently undergoing disciplinary actions for violations, including engaging in the chase without permission in violation of the pursuit policy, which states no more than two vehicles can engage in an authorized pursuit, but they have to first get permission from the supervisor. And so we know there were at least 60 other vehicles engaged that had not received that permission. Providing false information on their duty reports, and 19 disciplinary hearings are still pending. As far as the officers, the 13 officers involved in the shooting, administrative disciplinary actions are pending, awaiting a ruling from the county prosecutor's office as to whether criminal charges will be filed. Now, it's been roughly 10 months since this incident occurred. I think the county prosecutor has had the case now at least 6 months. Ms. Bledsoe is the administrator for the Cleveland Office of Professional Standards, so she might be able to give you more definitive dates on that. She was part of the administrative review with the disciplinary actions for the Cleveland police officers thus far.
That is a summary of this incident, and I look forward to engaging in further dialogue and questions.
So in about the next 20 minutes, before we get to questions, we're going to cover the oversight role. First, we want to talk a little bit about this phenomenon of waistband shootings. It's something that the Office of Independent Review of the Sheriff's Department, we see, and no other jurisdictions must see it too. And the questions really go about, goes back to the issue of human performance, and in terms of how do we investigate those kind of shootings which occur when no weapon is found. Mr. Sibley, can you maybe expound upon that a little bit in terms of what are the distinct things that an oversight body should be looking for, the kind of questions that should be asked by the investigators when you have unarmed shootings and waistband shootings where a suspect allegedly reached for a waistband and therefore a threat was perceived?
Yeah. Present some particular investigative challenges, and one of the things that I've found in my career is that there are often a more challenging type of event for a police department to do a good investigation of when compared to, say, a shooting where the suspect has a firearm that he brandishes. And so what I'm just going to very briefly do is talk about the kinds of questions that you're trying to answer when you conduct an investigation of a shooting such as a waistband shooting, and some particular issues that you might want to pay special attention to. So I'm going to try and kill two birds with one stone. We don't have very much time, but one of the things that was referenced but I wanted to say a little bit more about is the objective reasonableness standard. That's the case that essentially defines the Fourth Amendment standard for the use of force by police officers. It's also a case that is mirrored closely by a lot of administrative policies that agencies use around the country, and that's certainly the case for the Los Angeles Police Department. Our administrative standard is that an officer can use force that's objectively reasonable, so it's essentially the same standard. What that means from a review perspective, from an adjudicator's perspective, is that you need to determine the objective factors that were known to the officer at the time that the force was used. It does not matter that the officer, you know, interpreted these factors to mean that the person presented a threat, or interpreted these factors to mean that the person had a firearm, for instance. That's their interpretation, that's not the test. The test is whether an officer of similar training and experience, when faced with those same factors, would believe that they were facing a threat. It's a very important distinction, and it's one that's very often overlooked in an investigation, and I can't tell you how many times I've seen interviews with officers where they say, well, why did you fire? Well, he reached for his waistband and I believed that he was going to produce a gun and shoot me, and then they move on to the next issue in the investigation. Well, you cannot objectively evaluate that statement. That's a statement of subjective interpretation. So the investigation needs to focus very closely on what in fact occurred, what types of movements the suspect made, for instance. I might even want to step back a little bit from that. Waistband shootings rarely occur without some kind of a context. Typically, the police officer encountering the individual has some information about that individual, whether it's based on observations they've made of them as they're walking down the street prior to conducting a pedestrian stop on them, whether it's based on that person matching the description of a crime that's just occurred and knowing some details of that crime, whether that's, you know, based on an individual reporting something to a police officer saying, that's the guy, he just robbed me, he's got a gun in his pocket, something like that. So you need to determine what information was provided to the police officer ahead of the encounter with the suspect, what observations the police officer made of the suspect prior to the decision to shoot being made. And let's give you a for instance. Imagine, if you haven't done this, I would imagine most of you have not, carrying an unsecured firearm in your waistband. It's very, very, very rare that criminals use holsters when they carry guns. They usually tuck the gun in their, in the top of their pants. A gun is a heavy object, typically. You can get some very small guns, but by and large, guns are difficult to carry that way. So how would you walk around if you were carrying such a thing? What you will see with people who act just as they're walking, that they will touch it to make sure that it's still in place, so on and so forth. Officers can make those kinds of observations which may cause them to believe that a person was carrying a gun. So those are the kind of things I'm talking about. You need to talk about what observations were made, what information was provided. You need to inquire in your investigation as to how the suspect in fact reached to their waistband. What does that even mean? I've seen a whole range of these, from people running, you know, the hand goes to the waistband as they're pumping their arms. Well, that's not very much use, and that's unlikely to be a reasonable basis for a shooting, versus somebody, for instance, lifting up an overgarment and reaching into their waistband would be much more consistent with somebody trying to remove a weapon from their waistband. So you need to get a very detailed description of what it is that the person did. You also want to get a detailed description of any items that were seen. Many of our waistband shootings actually occur when a police officer mistakes a phone that is clipped to somebody's belt for being a gun, or a wallet or a phone that is being pulled from a pocket for being a gun. And a line of questioning that I've seen very often is, well, okay, what did you see? Well, I saw him start to pull an object out of his pocket. What did you believe that object was? Well, I believed it was a gun. Again, that's not useful for an objective analysis. You need to know what the item looked like, what size was it, what color was it, what shape was it, so that when you look at those facts, you can determine whether an officer of similar training and experience would, when being confronted with somebody removing such an item from their pocket, in fact believe that that was or was not a threat. And then, without going on about this too much, there's just one other thing that I would want to add. Sometimes people say that they shot the person because they were reaching for the waistband, because they did not, in fact, have a good reason to shoot at the person. And so you should always question, in fact, whether or not the waistband reach occurred. And certainly you should always seek to verify or rule out the fact that that, in fact, occurred through your witness statements, through your interviews with other officers, video evidence, so on and so forth. As recently as in the last couple of weeks, I've seen one of these in our own agency where a video seemed to refute the claim of the police officer that the person had reached for their waistband. Sometimes when these things occur, and this is the last thing I'll say on this, is that an officer has had a negligent discharge and they're trying to explain this without admitting to the fact they've had a negligent discharge. Some of the indicators of that are that they only fire one round, that they miss and they stop firing. And sometimes, especially if they're carrying a lightweight frame gun like a Glock, that the gun will stovepipe because they weren't holding the gun properly when they discharged it. So.
Thank you.
That's my comment on that.
Now, you did mention one thing which jumped out at me, sir. To respond to the pre-assault threat cues of an assault without waiting for the actual assault to commence. Now, Professor Viola, you and I briefly talked about that earlier this morning, and it seems to be kind of the ultimate offshoot of Garner, of the state of mind shooting, and that an officer can rely upon pre-assault cues. Can you kind of explain why that is a risky state of mind to engage in?
And I'll try and keep it brief as well. So that presupposes that you're an automaton, that here are the rules. If you see this, this, and this, then shoot somebody. And it's rubbish. I'll borrow a more polite phrase than what first came to mind. The problem with it is, as a police officer, especially as an experienced police officer, after you encounter people in potential threat situations, say for 5 years, 10,000 scenarios, you develop expertise. You're supposed to read the person. What's that person doing? What are their intentions based on what you see and perceive? That's subjective still, but you can act on that, and you should be looking at all of those cues to understand what this apparent sudden movement is really about as best you can. You don't have to wait to get shot. You got that part right, I think. But there's a hell of a lot more to it than just those three pieces. The justice in the workplace part has to do with, is it possible? What's your training? How are you trained to deal with deadly encounters? Do you get those sorts of training? Some of the research we did showed that about 95% of the police officers, several hundred that responded to a survey we did trying to understand the details about deadly encounters, about 95% of them relied on Force Science Institute for their training and their knowledge of how encounters work and what they should do. think those folks are well intentioned, but they don't use anything that rises to what I would call experimental science. It's low ends. There's a good report out right now by an experimental psychologist just critiquing the science in that institute.
And if I could jump back on that for a second, for those who don't necessarily know, Forest Science Institute is kind of an offshoot of an expert witness named Bill Lewinsky from Minnesota State. Forest Science has become instrumental in educating departments across the country in use of forest and use of forest policy. And I've been through their 2 days seminar. And what they emphasize is that the border from staying alive and getting killed can pass in about a quarter of a second. So if you look at Garner, you look at those threat cues, you need to be able to respond to the threat before the threat fully develops. Did I get that essentially right?
Yes.
And that brings with it a set of dangers, and a set of dangers which can mean more force, more shootings, more things based upon perception necessarily, and that ties right into what Django was talking about, but then importance of the post-event investigation, but really asking the right questions about what was said. And as an example, about 95%, I'll go back to you. I'll tie back into Merrick's report back in 2011. One of the things that he recommended for the Sheriff's Department was recurring, repeating, and structured tactical and survival school training, the task training. To prepare for today, I asked somebody at training in my department this question, which is, I'm interested in waistband unknown object scenarios, which are part of tasks or tactics and survival training. This is in reference to Merrick Bob's report in 2011, focusing on shootings of unarmed suspects. The response I got back was, good morning, Walter. I think the most compelling study done on state-of-mind shootings was done by Lewinsky from the Forest Science Institute. So really didn't answer the question, which is our concern about recurring training. So can you talk about that? Why is that training so critical, and the type of training which an effective department should be engaging in?
So let me give you the bad news part of this. And I've been looking at this problem now concretely and intensely with the research team we've put together for 7 years. This has been the focus, and I've been, got almost 50 years of work experience and a fair amount of combat experience in as a cop and in Vietnam. The thing that's missing out of what you're trying to do, out of the law, out of what the police agencies are trying to do to deal with this, no one's ever validated the training. I don't mean that there isn't a consensus among experts about what's good training and what the issues are. No one's ever shown this training affects performance in combat situations in the direction you would want or not. It's just never been done. Partly the reason has been it's difficult as hell to do. It would take a massive effort if you were doing it epidemiologically in the streets, monitoring every shooting situation, getting what information you could. But there are experimental ways to do it. That's the kind of thing we're doing in our lab. It's doable. It's just never been done. Every state in the nation has a Peace Officer Standards and Training Commission or some variant. Every single one of them says if you do this training and you pass, you're certified as qualified to carry a firearm as a peace officer. They say the director of several years ago, the director of the National Association of these associations said, and every single one of our standards is validated. What he meant was it's got agreement among people in that group. As a scientist, that's not even close to good enough. I mean, it's really not. It doesn't meet the standards of any kind of reasonable field experimentation or anything else. I'm not looking for astrophysics. I'm just saying the basic thing has not been done because we thought, well, it's too hard. We've never put the effort behind it. So.
Thank you. Now, as we wrap up and we get on to questions, let me just go on to that last question of influencing policy. And I think, for example, the LA Sheriff's Department has done some good work in trying to deal with the issue of unarmed shootings based upon their own internal analysis what our office has done in terms of our report writing and our ninth annual report of an unarmed shootings, again, what America has done. And the question is, the department has looked at, first of all, unarmed shootings is supposed to have a 90-day review policy. That they go in front of a review board much quicker than armed shootings because it recognizes those additional factors involved. But in addition, there also were, I think, accurate recording of armed versus unarmed is important. Asking yourself, does our department, we have oversight over, do they have a criteria, a method of measuring, a method of looking at these shootings, of getting an understanding of how many unarmed shootings are occurring? Is there a current tactical decision making which is taking place? That tactical decision making training is critical, and you have to see what is our department doing. Are they just getting our officers state certified so they go out to the range once every 12 months to prove that they know how to shoot and hit a target? Or are they actually going through training scenarios which require tough decision making scenarios which they will encounter out in the street? In terms of an oversight issue, does the department, for example, like the sheriff's department, have a designated commander who was supposed to be reaching out to the deceased's family and to the community? Remember, because there are shootings and there are shootings, and often it's those unarmed shootings which get that significant community outcry, which get that quote-unquote backlash where questions are demanded. Not that shootings necessarily, if somebody does have a weapon, is inherently in policy, but it's those type of unarmed shootings which really get a reaction, which is what Professor Dunn was talking about earlier. And finally, is there a special protocol for unarmed officer-involved shootings, something which the LASD has developed? So those are just some policy ideas. We've run through most of the program. We have about 17 or 18 minutes left. Again, thank you all of you, and please, let's go to questions. Everybody's in stunned silence. Was it that comprehensive? Please come on board.
My name is Jesse Kerworth. I live here in Salt Lake City. I'm an independent journalist. My question is about, you mentioned that LA recognizes a vehicle as a deadly weapon, and I think all of us know that if you get hit by a car, that might kill you. But I've thought about this a lot in the physics of a situation in which the car is traveling at an inertia that is threatening the officer, but at such a point that killing the driver will stop the inertia adequately to protect the driver, are so few. I mean, it just seems so hard to believe. I mean, cars don't have a, oops, the driver is dead, I better stop mechanism. So rarely does it seem like that would make sense, but here in Salt Lake City, at least, that's an excuse that gets used a lot. So I was wondering if you could comment more about a vehicle as a deadly weapon.
Yeah, your point's very well made. Shooting at somebody does not reliably stop a vehicle doesn't necessarily remove a threat if in fact that threat is presented by the vehicle. The most effective way to counter that threat is to move out of the path of the vehicle, or preferably not place yourself in the path in the first place. Because of that basic truth, which is borne out by any number of events around the country over the years, many agencies, LAPD included, prohibit officers from firing at moving vehicles if the threat that they are firing in response to is the vehicle itself. An officer is still authorized to fire a weapon if, for instance, the person in the vehicle is shooting at them. But the threat is the vehicle, they are not. They're required instead to reject this path.
And of course, there's another issue also, shooting at vehicles, especially if you're shooting at an oncoming vehicle and shooting through the windshield. Almost inevitably, you get deflection issues. That what you're shooting was to be thought that the target was the driver and you hit the windshield. What occurs, you get deflection and movement of the bullets that actually goes on to somewhere else. I responded to a shooting scene just about 2 months ago with a vehicle where the deputy was firing at the driver. He did perceive a threat. I won't go into any details, but ultimately the rear passenger was shot. But you look at the entry into the window, you think you're shooting right at the driver. Yes?
I'm Morgan Frazier. I'm the police monitor in Austin, Texas. Would you please comment a little bit about it? But obviously, departments can influence that state of mind by the very, you know, everybody's out to kill you sort of training or investigation outcomes, or even rhetoric that you hear from the chief administrators. Can you give us, as oversight persons, some suggestions on how we can try and counter
My perspective on the best way to reduce the incidence of these types of events is that you have to focus on tactical performance. You will see these, you know, kind of waistband, quote-unquote, shootings occur generally in certain types of scenarios. Those, for instance, might be foot pursuits of people who are believed to be armed, maybe high-risk traffic stops where the officer, instead of staying back behind their vehicle doors, instead decides to approach the vehicle. And I think what you should aim to do, and what every police agency should aim to do, and as the oversight entity you may be in a position to influence this, is to encourage the officers to consistently use good tactics. That will reduce the number of occasions where they find themselves in a position where they have to make a split-second decision. By the time you get to the split-second decision point, I think it's too late. By and large, people are going to make mistakes, maybe quite legitimately if you look at it in isolation. The best way to avoid having officers shoot people based on a misperception that the person is armed is to not have them be in a situation where they have to make a split-second decision. So good vehicle stop tactics, a good foot pursuit training program, and so on, are ways that you can influence that.
Yes?
Just one add-on to that. There's a field of study called normal accident theory. It's used to explain the Exxon Valdez, the space shuttle Challenger, Three Mile Island. You take a complex system failing and a tragedy that was unforeseen by people whose job it was to do that, and that explains why things go wrong. That's the more people, less options side of it. I don't know of training programs, and maybe the new ones in LASD and LAPD do a training about how many people are there, what's the speed of this thing, how can we slow the incident down while still containing it, for example, would be we were talking earlier, in the UK, police officers actually back down in some settings. In our country, you don't back down. No matter how it escalates, you don't back down. If you're good, you de-escalate as best you can. There are times when it might make sense to do so, and it's heresy, and it runs against anything I ever thought of as a street cop myself. But that line of thought deserves some careful consideration, I think.
Yes.
Yes, hi there, thank you very much. I wanted to ask you with regard to a follow-up question regarding, can you hear me? There we go. Hi, I want to talk to you with regard to a follow-up question on the Cleveland incident, the Cleveland shooting. My name's Jessica Cole, and I work at the Office of Citizen Complaints in San Francisco. I'm an investigator. And with regard to accurate reporting, what I wanted to speak to you about was, you said that you had some pending matters with regard to some officers that had not accurately, potentially not accurately recorded on their duty reports, and that was pending. And I wanted to ask you, with regard to that, whether or not there were something with regard to false statements, and I wanted to know, were these signed under penalty of perjury, and what's the follow-up on that? And if they are signed under penalty of perjury, are there Brady consequences for that? Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for your question.
And what does happen, and what are the disciplinary consequences?
Okay. Thank you. Well, unfortunately, I do not have the answers to that. My information primarily came from the report from the AG's office. The investigation, the administrative penalties that have been administered thus far have come from the mayor's office through the safety director and the chief. So those that are still pending for falsifying duty reports, those are left, if I'm not mistaken, and Ms. Bledsoe, please correct me here, those are left to the discretion of the safety director. I have not been personally directly involved in the investigation or any of the administrative review. So therefore, unfortunately, I cannot answer any further on those questions.
And I would add this, as far as the agency I deal with, it does not require, there's a false statements and reports policy, which is not required that the false statement be signed under penalty of perjury. But it, you know, has to be material. Yes, sir.
My name is John Alden. I'm an attorney with the San Francisco Police Department in the Internal Affairs Division. And Professor Vila, you were mentioning that there was a recent study that had a critique of some of the work done by Four Science Institute. Could you tell us a little bit more about that and how we could find the study? I'd like to know.
I can send it to you.
That'd be great. I'll
it's done by a colleague of mine whom I didn't know at the time, who's an experimental psychologist, focuses primarily on decision making. And she just, you know, took the thing apart very carefully. I've talked with her since, and it's a nice, it's a good piece of scientific critique.
Sure. Also, the CDC, I think out of Edmonton, wrote a really critical piece out of Canada regarding testimony by Forest Science in some litigation taking place in Canada. It was really the most direct critique I've seen of, in a mass media setting, of Forest Science and this type of testimony ever, and I'd encourage you to go look for it because I think it should be influential.
And would you guys put those names on NACOLE's listserv so
sure.
We can all see it?
We'll do it.
And just one thing, I mean, the Forest Science Institute is filling an utter vacuum that's out there. You have individual trainers who are retired police officers who go out and teach their school or another school of thinking, but the problem exists because there's nothing better. They have an email that comes out regularly. Bill Lewinsky goes out and does research as best he can with no external funding to speak of and takes a whack at it. The problem is it gets generalized and becomes cant in that whole field. And there needs to be some science in the Forest Science.
Good morning, I'm Mark Smith. I'm the independent police auditor for the San Francisco Mayor Rapid Transit. And I appreciate the you including those links as well. I was going to ask the same thing. I think a lot of us are interested in that. Mr. Sibley talked specifically about the need to really encourage departments to have good training with the hope of minimizing the chances that they will need to get into a negative use of force situation that might turn out badly. And I think all of you have referenced this in different ways in your presentations. I'm a little curious about if you have any thoughts on the interplay between really effective training that a department might hold and incorporation of that into specific policies or training orders. For instance, is I've worked with a department that I recall one policy in particular dealt specifically with foot pursuits, and it had very specific rules on what can and cannot be done when officers engage in that. Other departments would never go to that level of detail. I'm not sure I know which is necessarily better or more advantageous, or if one does more harm than good by being too specific, if you have any impressions or thoughts.
Well, I think it is important to codify your tactical standards in a meaningful way, and the reason for that is twofold. On the one hand, you want to communicate to officers through training what you expect them to do. You can't expect them to behave in a particular way if you don't describe to them what that way is. But secondly, when it comes to accountability in the wake of an incident, you can only really hold officers to standards that you can demonstrate exist. And if you have not codified your tactical standards, you are not going to be able to hold people to those standards in a subsequent review. So that's one of the things that we're very focused on in our role relative to the LAPD is the manner in which standards are codified. Because in every case where we do critique somebody for their tactical decision making, we always have to do that with a point of reference, and that point of reference is the codified standard. So for both of those reasons, you do have to have a reasonable level of codification of what those standards are.
And am I correct in thinking about that? If someone behaves otherwise, I remember being on the street, and there you go in foot pursuit, and the last time you were in foot pursuit, we worked with partners in the old days. You and your partner said, we're not going to split up next time, right? Right. And there you go, over and over and over again. But in this setting, if there was a rule that said, don't split up, then and you did, then you'd have to justify why,
yes,
or have consequences for that. I mean, the discretion is one of the other cornerstones, in addition to specifying carefully what is expected usually, and then if you vary from that, you're on, you know, you need to justify.
Yeah, that's right. And the standard that we employ in LAPD is that any significant deviation from a tactical standard has to be justified. That's one of the things that the investigators will be charged with establishing, is whether or not there was any justification for the deviation from the tactical standard, such as, for instance, splitting up during a foot pursuit, which is generally a no-no. Absent a justification for a decision like that, then there would be some sanction for the involved officers.
Thank you. Yes, about 5 minutes left.
In the state of Illinois, we don't have death penalty, and we haven't, we had a moratorium on the death penalty around 1996, I think it was, because of all the wrongful convictions. So when it comes to state-sanctioned killings, the state itself hasn't killed anybody since 1996, but we have police officers who have killed over 60 people in the last 5 years. It almost makes me want to go and become a civil rights lawyer just to prosecute police officers who kill people in a state that doesn't have a death penalty. How do you deal with the fact that we have so many states that are now deciding that they are not going to have a death penalty, but the people who are shooting and killing people are the police?
I think the counterpoint to it, I mean, one of the things I have done is a history of capital punishment in the U.S., so I understand what you're saying. I think a community that made that decision would necessarily also be willing to accept the fact that a police officer could only go so far in dealing with a deadly threat, and that if other people are dying, they die. If bystanders are dying, or, you know, if you have a hostage situation, it's a very complex problem. The community that decides no use of deadly force, that's not who we are, then has to accept responsibility for the other deaths that do happen when you have bad people armed doing bad things. Or we have to invent some magic technology. I don't mean that being silly. I mean, we do have to think outside the box of firearms about things that can do that. And that's not beyond the realm of possibility. It's just not where we've been. I think the community accepts responsibility for the decisions they make.
Well, in that phrase, I want to go on to Professor Dunnett real quick in terms of community responsibility. Because in all these conversations, when I began with right was three shootings off the top. Those people in that community who've had a 24-year-old son shot and killed by the police, or two people shot 137 times, what is their role, and what could the oversight body do to get them engaged in that role? Because right now, they're the last people are talked about are the people in the community.
Well, once again, going back to my earlier statement, I think the oversight entity has a very important role in helping not only educate the community, but to address the outcry and the criticisms coming from the community. They have to help the community. The key word is the outreach piece. I think they have to help the community understand, once again, police procedure and some of the complexities that we've discussed here. Now, with that being said, there also has to be a balance that the community concerns has to be addressed. And I think that it's incumbent upon the oversight entity to be that voice for the community and City Hall and in the halls of power, where the citizens in those communities don't feel they necessarily have access or a voice. So that interest, and I think going back to Dr. Walker's comments yesterday, when we get back to the origins of civil civilian oversight coming out of the civil rights movement, it was because of the abuses that had been taking place, particularly in African-American and minority communities. So that gave rise to it, and we can't lose sight of that. And I think while the community oversight or civilian oversight entity has to maintain objectivity and rationality, they also should represent a voice for the powerless.
Thank you. Two more questions.
Yeah. Mexico Williams, Atlanta Citizen Review Board. We've had problems with shootings in the back. We've been trained at the Force Science Institute, and dealing with officers shooting two times automatically, okay? And sometimes a person might just try to go at an angle and get that back shot. In this case, it was a kid from a football game, the playoffs at the Dome, and he got killed. Well, I got a phone call at like 1 o'clock in the morning, you know? Come on out here, because I'm a community activist also. So I came out there with my videographer, and we met down there at the station, and we found out that we got a problem with not the regular police, but the transit police, who doesn't have any oversight, and don't want any oversight, and they're killing people. And we're looking at this family of people just all over the ground, all over the place, crying and everything, because this kid's dead. This teenager, and he shot two times in the back. And the police, the city police, can't deal with this situation. They're only dealing with the perimeter. And that's all they're dealing with, is the perimeter. And then they call the GBI out there and that sort of thing, and my videographer is getting all this information, okay? But what I want to know, what's going on with the private police that's policing the transit facilities, okay? Because we got a problem there that we got to address, and I got a charge going on right now of trying to get them to get oversight.
I think the answer would be as creating oversight anywhere. You find where the power is. Who's got authority over that transit agency? Is it a board, whoever it is there, and start engaging with them about the message you've heard here, that shootings are not a simple thing, but shootings do require oversight, no matter who does the shootings. Sir?
Yes, in view of the requirement for John Muntz, in view of the high requirement for performance in these situations, is there any effort to increase the physical fitness of the officers so that they can accomplish that? It seems like in some cases their very physical fitness could prevent them from performing in a very demanding situation.
Yes, up to a point. As we were discussing this morning before the meeting, for people on a SWAT team that's highly trained, for special operations folks who are going to rescue a hostage somewhere, those folks are terribly fit and they have a very straightforward job to do. I don't know of very many police departments in the U.S. that have a year-to-year-to-year fitness exam like you would have in the military. And then on top of that, you put the fact that it's back to these sleep issues. When you don't get enough sleep, the hormone system in the body says, give me something, and no, don't give me that salad. I want a Snickers bar, and I want it right now. The work I do at the University of Buffalo and with CDC, with John Violante in particular, we look at the effect of long work hours, which I haven't heard anybody in this venue talking about, so I'm raising it again, and fatigue and overtime and those pieces. That causes shift workers to become obese, have increasing incidence of metabolic disorders, to make poorer decisions, to have increased probability of accidents and errors. We've got that in policing now. We've all the data for that, but we've also got it for, like I said, 100 years of research in industrial hygiene in those areas. So fit is probably better. Experience really counts a lot, but we're not, you know, we're missing some of the factors I'd love to see collected in these after action reports that I think would be helpful.
Well, thank you, and I want to once again, we're actually 3 minutes over time. I want to thank the panel. I think I've heard things today, hopefully you've heard things today that I heard here before NACOLE. I'm going to thank Professor Dunn, Cleveland State. I'm going to thank Mr. Sibley, and of course, thank Professor Vila. Thank you so much for coming out and taking part in this. I really appreciate it. We also want to thank you for your participation.